It sounds unlike anything else in nature.
Ready for the sampling?
Yep, ready.
But for John Huckabee, it's the sound of a very uncomfortable patient.
Okay. I just try not to get it really close to their teeth because of that.
He's really annoyed.
Huckabee is on the lookout for symptoms of a deadly and contagious disease, a disease that kills bats by the millions.
There are a few small, depigmented areas of scarring on the wing, but overall looks like he's in very good shape.
This silver-haired bat doesn't seem to be a carrier, but a few months ago, a little brown bat arrived at his office outside Seattle.
As I was examining it, I saw that one of the wings had a lot of contracture and some wounds, some lesions on the wing, and had an appearance like there may have a fungal infection.
The odd scarring was a possible sign of white nose syndrome, one of the deadliest wildlife diseases in modern times. First discovered in New York State in 2006, white nose syndrome has killed more than 5.5 million bats and counting.
The bats get a fuzzy fungal growth on their muzzles, which makes it look white. White nose syndrome was really challenging when we first discovered it because it was not known to science. The fungus that causes white nose was not even named at that time.
Until recently, it wasn't known how the disease killed its victims. But new research suggests that bats with white nose wake up more often during hibernation. This causes them to burn through fat reserves that would usually sustain them through the winter. Starvation and death soon follow. In just a few short years, the epidemic raced across the country, spreading from the Northeast all the way to Nebraska and Oklahoma. But then it hit an enormous natural barrier. The Rocky Mountains kept the disease from reaching western bats, or so scientists thought, until Huckabee's discovery. Some speculate that an infected bat may have hitched a ride on a freight truck bound for Washington. Others think hikers or cavers may have unwittingly carried the fungus on their clothes or equipment. Since the first infected bat was found in the forest east of Seattle, the white-nosed fungus has been found twice more in Washington state, both near the original site.
Did you guys get a bat?
Yeah.
Cool.
Good job.
We have bats in the net.
Fear of a white-nosed outbreak has jump-started research, not just in Washington, but around the Northwest. In Oregon, researchers are trying to learn what species are present and how big the populations are.
Bats hang out in the dark. They hang out in these big cliffs and crevices that we can't access. So we've gone for decades without really understanding what's happening with bats.
Was it coming out?
Slowly.
There's really no way for us to ascertain what's happening with our bat populations without this kind of a coordinated, large-scale survey effort.
One was a juvenile, not sure what the other one was.
It will give us a finger on the pulse of what's going on with bat populations distribution-wise and numbers-wise around the state, so that if and when white nose does get here, then it'll put us in a position to be able to recognize that.
I'll grab the detector.
Okay.
Back in Washington, researchers such as Abby Tobin are trying to learn how bats spend their winters.
What type of habitats they're roosting in, if they're hibernating through the winter, or if they are kind of active throughout, and also looking at those habitats they're using and whether the environment there is conducive for the fungus to thrive.
Why don't we kind of go down a little bit to be away from the trail?
It would be a little more stable.
Yeah, so let's try down there.
She's setting up bat detectors, specialized microphones that can pick up bats' high-frequency calls.
Yeah, that's good. Oh, yeah.
Each bat has a unique echolocation call, and so we're able to identify them based on that call from those acoustic detectors.
Now I gotta turn the detector on.
From this, I can tell this is a canyon bat, and they have this typical kind of hockey stick shape look to their call.
In the lab, Tobin looks for small signs the disease is taking hold in Washington.
This is the silver-haired bat. This is the species that has been confirmed for the fungus that causes white nose syndrome. And there's a couple little, tiny little holes. And so for this species, I am looking right now to see if there's any damage to the wing membranes, which would be a sign that it had white nose syndrome. And then I will swab the bat to see if we detect any of the spores. It's important to detect white nose syndrome early because it allows us to get a sense of where it is, and so we might be able to do some sort of containment or treatment with the animals.
Although treatments for white nose are still unproven, there's hope that the natural tendencies of Western bats may help slow the disease's spread. Unlike their Western cousins, Eastern bats congregate in caves and mines to hibernate, sometimes by the thousands. The disease, which is spread primarily by bat-to-bat contact, can wreak havoc in these large colonies.
We have seen populations of bats in eastern colonies decline, in some cases, to 100%.
But western bats behave differently.
Our western bat species do not aggregate in these large numbers like they do in eastern North America during hibernation. We have a little more hope in Washington that our bats might not be infected as much as the bats in eastern North America have been.
These small differences in behavior may be what ultimately saves western bats, but it could be years before definitive answers emerge.